Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up, it's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, oh my soul. Worship His holy name. Sing like never. You're rich in love and You're slow to anger. Your name is great and Your heart is kind. For all Your goodness I will keep on singing. 10,000 reasons for my heart to sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time is come. Soon my soul will sing Your praise unending. 10,000 years and therefore sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Oh, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh my soul, we worship Your holy name. We worship Your holy name. We worship Your holy name.
Well, good morning and a very warm welcome to St. Andrew's Church this morning, whether you're staff, whether you're a student, whether you're a friend, family, supporter, or female cyclist who's got cut off from the peloton. It's very good to have you here this morning. On the news this morning, it was announced that the Conservative Party and the Labour Party are going to be working together to consider the tricky issue of the possible legalisation of cannabis. They're setting up a joint commission. Welcome to this joint commissioning, as we say goodbye to all those who've been part of this community and are now leaving to use all that they've learned in other places and in other roles. We should be hearing from some of them, we should be praying for them all and commissioning them for their new ministries, whatever those may be. It's really good to have Andrew Rumsey with us. Andrew is the Bishop of Ramsbury. And this is actually the second time that he's been with us this week, so we're particularly grateful. You can imagine what Oscar Wilde would have said. Thank you for your carelessness on the diary front. Andrew is the author of a number of books, one on parish, the subject he was talking to leavers about earlier in the week, a book of poems called Homing In, and one book entitled Strangely Warmed, Reflections on God, Life, and Bric-a-Brac. And Amazon tells me that if I like that, I will also like the NIV Tiny Navy Soft Tone Bible with Zip. And actually, that describes Andrew's writing style rather well. Soft-toned, but with zip. Andrew was my parish priest for a couple of years in South London, and the best parish priest I've ever had. He's also a long-standing friend, and it's lovely to have you with us this morning, Andrew. Let's be quiet for a moment. Would you like to stand? The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Down before thee, who was
though the eye of sinful man thy glory may not see. We have an opportunity now to bring before God an acknowledgement of our sinfulness, the way that it blocks us from seeing your glory and blocks others from seeing your glory in us. Let's pray together. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life, to the glory of your name. Amen. So may the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely. Forgive the eruptions of sin and sear the roots of sin in your deepest parts. And may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Set down into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see beauty that made this heart. Adore you, hope of our lives and give.
Would you sit? We now come to that rather dangerous part of the service where we let leaving students talk about their time here after we've written their final report. Over to you, Phil.
Hello. Dangerous indeed. I emailed Liz back and said, oh, you like to take a risk? It's the first time I've been an opening act for a bishop, so I suppose this will be interesting for us all. When I was first asked to do some talking at this thing, I wasn't surprised. Now, was that because of my great oratory skill or my keen theological insights? No? It's because I'm from Yorkshire. Well, the Bishop of Oxford is from Yorkshire. And what would he say if his great county was left unrepresented today? It'd be bad PR. You're not the only theological college in Oxford. So that's why I'm here. Well, this is how I've decided I'm here. And so when I first met my DDO in York a few years ago, and the DDO is the gatekeeper for ordination training, so you've got to kind of get past him to have a chance. And he said, so Phil, what do you want me to do for you? And I thought, oh, open goal. So I said, I'd like to study at Wycliffe and start in September. And he went, no, you're off to Durham, you're off to Cranmer. And so the debate began. And there were many reasons why I wanted to come to Wycliffe, but one of the main ones was that the year previously, 4 years ago, I did the CTS. And I was bombarded by people saying, Phil, you should get ordained. Phil, you should get ordained. Tutors, ordinands, independent students, even clergy I just met for the first time. Americans. Phil, have you thought about being a pastor? And when Americans say things, you've got to take notice. So I had to take notice of it. And so here I am. And, you know, there's so many times this last couple of years where I've gone, Phil, you are so blessed. It wasn't a Wycliffe, but no, to be fair. It's been a mad 2 years with lockdowns, and it's been challenging for us all. But I wouldn't have changed it for anything. And it's just such a commendation to the tutors and to the staff and everyone who have managed to make this place in that time safe, that we could meet together quite often, actually, and be able to have community and still feel safe and care for one another. And there's not been teething problems, but you know, well done, good job. Not that my opinion counts for much, but although, you know, I am from Yorkshire and the Bishop of Oxford is from Yorkshire, so you've got to count a little bit. So, you know, great stuff, well done. I wouldn't have changed it for anything, and I'm so happy. I'm blessed to be here to train. So I think the best thing I could do is share a scripture that I keep coming back to. And in a place, a theological college, there is so often you could be in comparison with one another. You could be envious, jealous, concerned. You might actually take an inappropriate interest in other people's calling and think you might have to be the one to shape their calling or change them and all those kind of things. And I keep coming back to John 21. Jesus has risen and he is having breakfast with his disciples on the seaside. Not Scarborough, but you know. And he takes Peter aside and says, you know, Peter, I know you denied me, but you're still going to be head of my church, but that will lead to your death. And Peter looks over Jesus' shoulder, or, you know, he sees John. And there's a bit of tension with John and Peter in John's gospel. And he goes, what about him, Lord? And Jesus says, paraphrase, what has that got to do with you? You follow me. And I think Ephesians 2:10 says it well. For we are what he has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand to be our way of life. Whatever we do, whether big or small in the world's eyes, is eternally significant in God's eyes. So rejoice in your call and each other's. And to paraphrase Augustine, love God and do what you want. Thank you, Wycliffe.
I am not Izzy, as your bulletin says. Izzy would be way more eloquent than I'm about to be. She's a good friend, and she's in the Theologos program with me. And so I'm up here as a representative of the Theologos and CTS program. And I'd like to begin with a list of 9 things I've learned whilst living in England. 1 for each month I've been here. Bear in mind that I lived here without my wife and kids during Michaelmas term, and that my primary purpose for being here was to take a sabbatical after 25 years of ministry. 1, I can go to bed at 10 p.m., wake up at 2 p.m., eat dinner, and go back to bed at 10 p.m., but only during Michaelmas term. 2, I have eaten dessert every day, and not once has it been pudding. 3, they're lady birds, not lady bugs. It's the pavement, not the sidewalk. These are trousers, not pants. 4, Brits love making rules and then not enforcing them. 5, I love learning, but I don't love writing papers. 6, my wife loves our children, but she does not love homeschooling them. 7, I can read 10 books in 2 days if you only have to read 3 paragraphs for it to count. 8, I'm 42 years old, and I can still pull an all-nighter. I did it this week to meet a paper deadline. And so if you see me yawning up here, you know why. That was 2 days ago, actually. 9, my jokes elicit more laughs and less groans than our principals. In all seriousness, there are 3 main reasons why the Lord called us to Wycliffe Hall: sabbatical, study, and discernment. And the Lord has met these things with healing, equipping, and clarity. Regarding sabbatical, Oxford might objectively be the most rejuvenating place in the world for rest, at least for an Anglican American. After 25 years in church work, I needed rest and healing. I needed physical healing, as became evident during my first term when I slept and slept and slept. I needed mental and emotional healing. I just needed to get out of the U.S. for a bit and to remember what it's like just to go to church or not to go to church. I needed spiritual healing. And I found that in the rhythms of daily prayer at Wycliffe Hall and at Pusey House. And I needed friendship, which I found with so many of you and in the pubs. Cask ale. We don't have cask ale in the United States. 2, my time at Wycliffe has been academically challenging and equipping. Frankly, it was humbling for me to choose to go back into an undergraduate program after receiving a master's degree in the U.S., but honestly, the rigor of the program here was equally challenging, if not more challenging, than my master's program in the U.S. I studied many of the same subjects that I've studied two or three times in the past, but fresh new approaches to the subjects has been invaluable to our future ministry. And really, the tutors here and the faculty and the staff have been, in a word, kind. In another word, non-anxious. In another word, lighthearted. These are things that we don't experience in the United States of anxiety. You are kind, and I'm very grateful for that. Lastly, we were given time and space for discernment, and the Lord has provided for us powerfully and with undeniable clarity. Coming here was an exercise of trust. We didn't know where we were going to go after Oxford when we came here. And I have been in discernment for holy orders in the Anglican Church in the U.S. for quite a while now, and I just needed some clarity with that. And so with the help of my bishop in the U.S. and with a spiritual director at Pusey House and with Max, my tutor, and with my Theologos friends and so many of you, it became evident to us in January, February, and March exactly where the Lord wanted us to go and that he does indeed want me to pursue holy orders when I return to the U.S. And to do this all with my family has been the privilege and adventure of a lifetime. Most of you have met Melissa, Lily, Liam, and Noel. I love you guys with all of my heart. We fly back to the States July 5th. We've officially begun grieving our departure from this heavenly place. We'll miss the slower pace of life, walking everywhere, being surrounded by non-anxious people. But we are leaving deeply fulfilled and ready for the adventure ahead. I'm leaving Wycliffe refreshed and healed, equipped and challenged, and confident in the calling God has for our second half of life in ministry. Thank you all for taking part in our adventure.
Hi, I'm Heather. I'm a mixed mode third year student, but I hope my experience at Wycliffe will resonate with some of your experiences. And when you come to spend a few years in one place, things happen in your life, unexpected things, important things. People get married, they have children, they move houses, their spouses get new jobs, people die. I chose Wycliffe Hall because I hoped to find a community here with whom I could do life. And I found just such a community, despite the challenges of COVID, which has really robbed us of some of the depth of relationships we would have liked to have had. My fellowship group has been more than I could have wished for as we've journeyed together and supported one another along the way. You guys are awesome. Thank you. The whole of Wycliffe, the whole Wycliffe community, has been a place where my mind has been stretched, my ideas have been challenged, and my passions have been stoked. All those conversations in the dining hall have been as much a part of my formation as lectures and chapel. And far from the reputation of theological training draining away your faith, being here has definitely deconstructed my understanding of the Bible, but it has reconstructed it in a better place. There was a time when I had a bit of a wobble whilst wrestling with the New Testament, and that was no fault of Peter or Erin's. But as Michael said in one of our first lectures here, the Bible can stand up to any question you want to ask it. Be not afraid. I'm sorry, I can't do the voice. If you've been in any lectures or tutorials or seminars with me, you'll know that I usually have a lot to say and I can't quite hold back. So I do apologize for my fellow students. But that's because being here has set me on fire. And my prayer is that we will all leave here and go out into the ministry, alight with the fire of the Holy Spirit. Thank you to all the tutors and all the staff at Wycliffe Hall. I have been blessed.
I shall not fear thou. first reading is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, starting at verse 12. But we appeal to you, brothers and sisters, to respect those who labor among you and have charge of you in the Lord and admonish you. Esteem them very highly in love because of their work. Be at peace among yourselves. And we urge you, beloved, to admonish the idlers, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, be patient with all of them. See that none of you repays evil for evil, but always seek to do good to one another and to all. Rejoice always, pray without ceasing, give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. Do not quench the spirit, do not despise the words of prophets, but test everything. Hold fast to what is good, abstain from every form of evil. May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. The one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Hear the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, O Lord. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and caught fish of every kind. When it was full, they drew it ashore, sat down, and put the good into baskets, but threw out the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all this? They answered, yes. And he said to them, therefore, every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old. When Jesus had finished these parables, he left that place. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Do please be seated. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. It's very good to be with you. Good morning. After that rarest of occasions, an England international footballing victory, and before our hopes ended in predictable disaster, an England supporter spilled out onto the street in Lewisham, South London, not far from where we used to live. Smartly dressed in a grey suit, but deliriously drunk, he was leaping and bobbing around the high street in ecstasy, really, chanting the result, 1-0, 1-0, so on, you know, the kind of chorus. As evangelical messages go, therefore, it was a simple one, and he announced it with glee, spilling out onto the street, and as he did so, he did this kind of strange, sort of bouncy football-supporting walk that you do when you're in that sort of state. Just sort of like that, constantly. You see them behind reporters on the television. And so it was that he bounced up to another fellow, wearing this time an England shirt, thinking reasonably enough that here he would find a kindred spirit. "One nil," he chanted again, right in his face. "One nil." At which the man in the England shirt grimaced and edged away, looking rather embarrassed. At which point our friend in the suit pointed at him and bellowed so that everyone could hear, "You wear the strip, but you don't believe." I'm sure that could never be said of those of you who are being ordained in a few short days' time. But whatever ministry you are embarking upon, I'm sure you'll agree that the crucial sign of your calling will be an unquenchable passion to share the news of what God has done for the world in our Lord Jesus Christ, a news that spills over like Prosecco or like a football supporter into the street and is unstoppable in its joy and can sometimes indeed make a nuisance of itself in public. It's a joyful and poignant day for you all today. It marks the culmination of this part of your journey and a sense of transition. We were looking at that in our session earlier this week, being between places for many of you, that unsettling sense of being kind of neither here nor there, coming and going all over the place. Deep gratitude is due today to those who have intentionally or inadvertently modeled to you the calling which you are following and obeying and embarking on in a new way now. We are so grateful. Many of them aren't here, of course, probably most of them aren't here, who have inspired and modeled the way of Christ to you. But they are with us in spirit as a mighty cloud of witnesses. And so as you are released from academic captivity back into your natural habitat, there is much to take with you from these two glorious Bible readings we've just heard. "Every scribe," says the Lord Jesus, "who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like the master of a household who brings out of their treasure what is new and what is old." Every scribe, every person learned in the law and word of God, who's been trained for the kingdom of heaven, is like the master of a household who brings out of their treasure what is new and what is old. Now, it's fair to say that the church, particularly the Church of England, isn't really short of old things. I noticed graffiti in one of the porches of one of my Wiltshire church doors recently, from 1698, etched into the door frame of the church. And I thought, 17th century ruffians have been at it again. Every Sunday I have to keep cleaning. We've got so much old stuff, have we not? We are even curators of the past. Those who are curates, as some of you will be, often notice quite soon that they have to be curators. They have to actually manage and steward what has been passed on to them. And like wise stewards and scribes, they have to sort through those old things that are no longer needed and which are true, which are the true and priceless pearls that we will lose at our peril. Ancient traditions can just be old mistakes, as Ignatius of Antioch wrote many, many, many centuries ago in so many words. Ancient traditions can just be old mistakes. The crucial word in the New Testament for this, of course, is paradosis. The passing on, the handing down of tradition. And it is used in the New Testament both in negative ways, friends, and positive ways. There can be a handing down of things that we don't need now and oughtn't to be passed on, that they should stop. They should be left behind. Worthless traditions. And sadly it is, I'm afraid, that the NIV translates the negative application of paradosis as tradition and says, uses other phrase, the handing down, for the translation of the positive aspects of paradosis, which is the same word, and it would be good if actually we could use tradition in a positive light in our exegesis. And perhaps because the church has been part of British life for so long, 1400 years at least, longer actually, its message may seem to many in our nation to be what you might call old news. And at a time of breathtaking social change, fearful of becoming marginalized and left behind or caricatured, the church can easily become enthralled with novelty. But we do not need chip paper ministers always trying to be relevant, always doomed to being just behind the times. For the wise minister brings out of their treasury not old news, but what you might call new olds. The ever ancient but ever fresh story of Jesus Christ, with its quite phenomenal power to turn upside down and inside out the world we think we know and understand. That which is truly radical, as you know, takes us back to the first roots and springs of our calling, which is, come, follow me. Christian faith, thank goodness, is not a lifestyle option that has to be brought up to date. People often ask me in radio interviews and things, how is Christianity relevant to life today? And in my annoying way, I answer, it is relevant to your life in the same way that a knock at your door is relevant to your life. It's a call upon you. It's an interruption. It's a call, a knock which you can ignore or not, but if you answer it and open the door, you may find your life being delivered in every sense. It is a call to become truly and fully alive through the holy mystery of dying to self. A call to serve and save a world that has so gorged itself on every kind of thrill and experience and consumer product and yet remains spiritually starving, longing for nutritious and satisfying food. And we know that Christ does not just call at the door of the religious or the churchy, far from it. He calls all kinds of people. I love those short parables that are just the inclusion in this vast net, gathering in all manner of creatures. Indeed, he seems keenest, does he not, very often on those who aren't religious, but are humble enough to know their need and are truly ready now to live. Announcing this call to follow Jesus Christ, not yesterday, not just tomorrow, but now, today, is what you will be about in your various ministries. It will take many different forms, but it is announcing this news that you are about. 1,000 other things will be demanded of you, many of which will be pressing and worthwhile. But never forget, dear friends, your first calling to make known the timeless gospel of Jesus Christ, which has been handed down to you from of old and is entrusted to you afresh this day. Indeed, woe betide us if we fail to pass on the timeless gospel of Christ. To be a minister of Christ does not require you to be perfect. Those of us who wear the strip or wear a strip find that that can occasionally play the trick on us and others. But I'm inclined to think that the more perfect you are, the greater is the likelihood of you getting in the way of Christ being known rather than you. You know that wonderful, I'm sure you've heard it many times, that wonderful Leonard Cohen lyric about the cracks being where the light gets in. There's a forget your perfect offering, ring the bell that still can ring. There's a crack in everything. That's where the light gets in. Church leaders are very human and frail women and men with a high calling, but very human failings. The test of life in ministry, probably the test of life as a whole, Christian life, is very often not how you will succeed in that task, but how you go wrong. As St. Paul and St. Peter, those two founding stones of the church, knew so well. You know very well that Christians are not better than other people. They just have a unique way of failing. Like Buzz Lightyear, you remember? Falling with style. And that's sometimes, God forgive us, it's not stylish at all. But it is the way in which we respond to and offer to God our brokenness that enables us again and again to face life's dead ends, to start afresh in his living way. And all the best of our words in church, grace, redemption, forgiveness, resurrection, are about this remarkable possibility of finding a route back on to the way of Christ by the Holy Spirit working within us. And as Paul writes to the Thessalonian church in our first reading, the slow road to holiness and sanctification is not something that, first of all, we achieve for God, but something that God achieves for us and in us by his foregoing, his prevenient grace in our lives. Only if you know and show your deep dependence upon the living God will others be able to see him at work in you and see his light shining through the cracks in your clay. As for that ecstatic football supporter, the good news of Christ is of a victory won for us, not by us. We are simply here to get others to sing along. So, dear friends, it is Christ who calls you, Christ who serves you before you are truly able to serve others, Christ whose peerless self-giving you are now to make known to a watching world. And as he has proved through the ages, the one who calls you is faithful, and he will do this. May it be so. Amen.
from the rising of the sun to its setting. Let us bring our prayers before the Lord. God of all creation, we thank you that you've called us to be a family, your family, of love here on this earth. We acknowledge our call to radiate your warmth and to reflect your light and love into this world that we inhabit. As we, your church, continue to celebrate and worship your name, give us the attentiveness of mind, strength of body, and softness of heart to hear your voice and to look for your presence in and around us, and to act faithfully in love as we each go on our journeys. We pray for courage and protection, for the strength and for all our leaders, praying for the various leaders of the church, for the Archbishops Justin and Stephen, for Bishop Andrew, for Bishop Stephen, the Bishop of Oxford, for Pope Francis, Patriarch Bartholomew, and all of the leaders of the free churches. Will you, Lord God of all, be pleased to sustain and strengthen your church and all who are willing to serve in it, in whatever capacity that may be. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our world, for the ongoing wars and violence, the food shortages, the famines, the rising cost of living affecting all those unable to make ends meet, for the greed far too often encouraged and on display, for the damage inflicted upon our world, for so many areas where we need your rule and reign, Lord. Will you, by your mercy, please help us and the whole world to acknowledge you as King of both this good earth and all of humanity. Please bring your peace to those situations of conflict, respite and healing for those suffering, and justice where your law of love is rejected or transgressed. Please grant our leaders, Her Majesty Queen Elizabeth, and all her ministers, with wisdom and peaceful conviction, to govern with justice, love, and mercy, responding to the needs of the poor, the downcast, and the downtrodden. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Holy Spirit, we ask for your presence with us this day, in our community here at Wycliffe Hall, at the centre of Oxford, for our staff and our students. May you continue to sustain this community as a place of prayer, study, formation, and hospitality. We pray today especially for those in this community who will be moving on into new experiences, whether that be close by or far off. May they look back at this time as a key part of their journey, that despite the joys and opportunities taken away from them, perhaps because of COVID, that they may see the years restored to them in what is next to come. Bless them, generous Father, with good gifts that you know so well to give. Please remind them of your presence with them as they go into new environments, and we ask that you provide them with a loving and caring community that can support them through both the joys and the challenges of their ministry. God, be their light in the coming years. Lord, in your mercy. And Christ our King, we lift our own lives before you. We pause now to consider our place before you. We're sorry for the times when we have let you down. Please forgive us. We ask you to pour out your Holy Spirit into our lives, that we may go out in newness of life on fire with love for you and for our world. Sustain us in the dark times, remind us of your presence in the good times, and open our eyes to see your work in our own journeys, in the way that you are shaping us into your likeness. Help us to remain open to your ongoing progress in our lives, knowing that that the best is yet to come. So we gather and conclude our prayers by asking, Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Would you stand? Be at peace among yourselves, says our epistle reading. And in order to be at peace with one another, we need the peace and the peacemaking power of God. So the peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us offer one another a sign of that peace. at the risk of doing my cabin crew impersonation, there will be three stations for communion when we get to the administration. One will be here at the front, one will be at the side altar there, and one will be on the, southwest portico, I suppose, would be the right way of putting it. If you would like non-alcoholic wine, then do come to the front. If you would like to, they will be in cups, so if you would rather drink from a cup than dip into the chalice, then come to the front, and there's also gluten-free bread available at the front. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. After the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. As our Savior taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done in earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. So draw near in faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Jesus Messiah,
His blood the wine, broken and poured out all for love. The whole earth trembled and the veil was torn. Love so amazing, love so amazing.
Let's stand and sing.
Jesus Messiah, name above all names, blessed Redeemer, Emmanuel, the rescue for sin.
Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. Would you sit? Now we're going to have the kind of hall of fame into which the leaving students are going to be inducted, and we're going to do it fellowship group by fellowship group.
We're going to start with the A's. And do stand with your friends and supporters, so everyone, I think, here in the front row. This is our fellowship group. We've got Adam and Ruth Wharton, and Heather and Andy McCulloch with Catherine and Kane. Welcome. I can see Azita and Cam Jabari, and Jess and Jake Ross. Going off into parishes in the Diocese of Winchester and Worcester and Oxford.
And also we have James Bremner together. And I can see Beth and Theodora, and I think Adeline is somewhere here too, who they will be going to serve in St. Bartholomew's Binley in the Coventry Diocese. And Philippa Kalungi as well, would you stand? Both have done so much in our Wycliffe community. Philippa's going to be Director of Women's Ministry and Spiritual Formation in North Carolina.
From our fellowship group, we're losing Ed Yates and Jane. We're going to serve in a parish and a school, we hope, in Newbury. And we have as well Al Horn. Al and his family are going to continue to serve in St. Ebb's Headington, so very local. And then we have Johnny and Susie Guy. I'm sure they're going to take Joey with them as well, but they're going to be serving in a parish in York. That is our group.
In our Monday group, we say farewell or hang on to David Clifton, who's been leading our worship, who's not going anywhere. Wayne kisses Solomon and Nicole and their dog Heidi are going to serve as a youth leader in an Outward Bound center near Farringdon. And Jonathan McNally is here. Shuttling up and down the M40 between Oxford and Walsall and the M6. And then from the Tuesday group, Tom Chapman is in Washington, D.C. at the Museum of the Bible right now, but is with us. So he's going on to Litchfield. Tom is a bit of a biblical scholar. Rosemary Loudon is here with Martin. She's returning to serve in prison at Her Majesty's Prison, Rye Hill, and will do a touch of curacy in the Coventry Diocese, we hope. Jessica Miss Kelly is going back to the USA for a beautiful fusion of music and ministry. Ashley Schroeder fuses business and Christian witness in the US of A. Henry Swain and Tor are here. With Paisley and Jager. They're going to serve in the Diocese of Oxford, not far from here. In fact, in this very church. And Lisa Taylor is here. And she will go to serve in the Holland team on the edge of the Peak District in the Diocese of Derby. Bless you guys.
from my group, we have Kristen Ranker. And Chris is going home for a well-deserved rest before discerning a call to be a missionary in India. And we are also saying goodbye to two PCGE students, Charles Whipp and Emily Hall.
From the Theologos group, we're seeing quite a number of people are carrying on next year to do the BTH. They couldn't escape. But those who we're saying goodbye to are Isabel Boerman, Ryan Flanagan, Sam Flood, John Parrott, and Daniel Wenninger.
From our group, we're saying goodbye to Sarah Parsons. Sarah's going back to the USA to serve in youth ministry. And we're saying goodbye to Josh and Claire and Luke and Peter, Josh Horden and family. They're not going far. They're going to the Cowley Team Ministry and Grace Church in Oxford Diocese. And then finally, we're saying goodbye to Mike and Caroline Darbandi and Jasper and Boaz. And they're continuing in their pioneering church plant in Gas Street in Birmingham.
We're saying our farewells to Philip McKenning, who you may remember introduced himself earlier, and he's heading to the Parish of the Resurrection in Doncaster. And we're saying farewell to James and Mel West, Judah. Together with Judah, Anna, and Joshua, who are off to Christ Church, Turnham Green in Chiswick, London Diocese.
Well, it's my very great pleasure to be able to read out the names of our graduate community who are leaving. Unfortunately, as we are bang smack in the middle of graduate exams and to the final deadlines, unfortunately, many of our graduates cannot be here. But in true Wycliffe style, if we could still clap and hopefully loud enough that whatever library, whatever exam hall, or whatever study space they're in, they might still be able to hear us. And so we have Emma Barnes. We have Dominic Doan, Kyle Edwards, Nick Galvin, Hannah Heather, Henrik Heitman, John McQuillan, Alberto Solano Zatarain, and Joey Tomasoni. And we send with our claps all their prayers for their continued studies and for their examinations.
And last, but not least, I'm very proud of all of the leavers in my fellowship group. And let me just say what an honor it is to read your names and celebrate the completion of your studies with you. James, Jess, and Moses Congreve Horn. Neil DeMonte. Andrew, Elizabeth, Gabe, and Jesse Gilmore. Crispin, Diane, Damari, and DeAndre Gums. Simon Jones. Shannon Parrott. Joan Taka. And Marcia and James Wadham.
If you could remain standing, let's all pray for all of them. Lord God, we thank you for these scribes who've been trained for the kingdom of heaven. We thank you for the treasure that they have stumbled across. We thank you that they've all been prepared to sell, for all that they've been prepared to sell and to leave behind in order to possess that treasure. We thank you that they have opted for solid joys and lasting treasure over the fleeting pleasures of that which displeases you because it corrodes us. We thank you that they've chosen what they cannot lose over what they cannot keep. We thank you that they preferred that which will be refined in the fire to that which will be burned up by it. We thank you that they found in the Lord Jesus Christ that value that surpasses all else. May the joy of that discovery keep deepening in them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, we thank you for the storerooms in each one of them that you have been filling. We thank you for the old treasures that you've placed within them, for all the truths and glories of the Hebrew Bible and the Jewish tradition. We thank you for the knowledge of you, the one God, and the call to orientate ourselves healingly and enlargingly towards you, and thereby to align ourselves reconcilingly and harmoniously with all others. We thank you for the knowledge of your faithfulness and your inducing of faithfulness in us. We thank you for the knowledge of who we are, made to reflect your beauty and to order your world. We thank you for the reality and the psychological health of the words you gave us to speak to you. We thank you for the new treasures you have placed within them, for the shock of the new understanding of yourself that erupted into the world in the person of your Son, for the challenges of his teaching, the hope of his actions, and the glory of his character. For the way he did not repay evil with evil in his arrest, condemnation, torture, and death. And for the entropy-defying power of his resurrection. We thank you for the new knowledge that you are relationship, that you are love. And for the call to live that love, share that love, reveal that love, be that love to a world that struggles to consider itself lovable. Lord, in your mercy, keep filling these treasure chests, we pray, with more and more insight into the sources of wisdom, old and new. So that on every occasion, in every conversation, for every decision, they may be bringing out from their storeroom the very truth that is needed. Words that will sustain the weary, encourage the faint-hearted, help the weak, restrain the aggressive, restore the ashamed, and affirm the criticized. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for these scribes who have been trained for your kingdom. Make them agents of that kingdom, we pray. Make them people who live the values and submit to the laws and speak the language of the kingdom. Language characterized by truthfulness, gentleness, kindness, purity, wisdom, and love. Make them people whose living of the kingdom makes others want to sell all that they own, to have for themselves what they see in these scribes. Make them people whose kingdom lives enable all that is exploitative, unjust, or impure to be seen for what it is. May their kingdom living be nowhere more evident than in their families, and give to their homes, we pray, your lasting peace. Amen. Let's all stand. Into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Render to no one evil for evil. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Honor all people. Love and serve the Lord, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you this day and forevermore. Amen.
Be thou.